Good evening, everyone. I would like to call this meeting of the Somerset Berkley Regional School Committee to order at 6 p.m. due notice having been posted. Let the record show that this meeting is being electronically recorded. And if anyone in the audience also wishes to electronically record this meeting, you should notify the committee at this time. Any such recording may be subject to reasonable restrictions imposed by the chair to the extent those restrictions are permitted under the open meeting law. Having heard no response, I assume that there is no one present who intends to record all or a part of the meeting. Roll call, Ms. White?
Here.
Mr. Camara?
Here.
Mr. Ghilarducci?
Here.
Mr. Kelly?
Here.
Mrs. Gagliardi?
Here.
Mrs. Rothwell?
Here.
At this time, I would ask everyone to stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. For the information of the committee, after the Somerset School Committee meeting last Tuesday evening, I was informed that the Somerset Committee would like to meet this evening. I reminded them that this was our regularly scheduled meeting night, but they asked for an accommodation. So we worked out a schedule where we would meet at 6 o'clock. We would have our joint session at 7:15, and the Somerset Committee will meet at 8 o'clock. Because we're limited to an hour and 15 minutes, we'll have to move through our agenda promptly, and we may move around so that we're sure to cover those items which we really have to address this evening. First item on the agenda is to accept the open session minutes 1 and 2 of the July 8, 2013 meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Camara and seconded by Mr. Ghilarducci. Is there any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Next is to consider acceptance of open session minutes 1 and 2 of the April 10th, 2013 meeting. Five members of the committee, Mr. Kelly, Mrs. Gagliardi, Ms. White, and Mr. Camara and myself are present at that meeting, as well as the remaining meetings that are listed on the agenda. May I have a motion to accept the open session minutes of April 10th, 2013?
So moved. Second.
Okay, motion made by Ms. White and seconded by Mr. Kelly. Any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? And Ms. Ghilarducci and Mrs. Rothwell abstained. All right, next item is to consider acceptance of the executive session minutes of February 28th, 2013. You have a motion to that effect?
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Camara and seconded by Mrs. Gagliardi. Any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Five in the affirmative, two abstentions, Mrs. Rothwell and Mr. Ghilarducci. Next item is to consider the acceptance of executive session minutes of March 14th, 2013. I have a motion to that effect.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Motion made by Ms. White and seconded by Mr. Camara. Is there discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? No. Five in the affirmative, two abstentions, Mrs. Rothwell and Mr. Ghilarducci abstain. Next item, consider acceptance of executive session minutes of April 10th, 2013. May I have a motion to that effect?
Second.
Motion made by Ms. White and seconded by Mrs. Gagliardi. Is there discussion? In the absence of discussion.
I'm sorry, I have to abstain. April? No. Yes. No, I'm good.
Okay, in the absence of discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Five in the affirmative and two abstentions, Mrs. Rothwell and Mr. Ghilarducci. Next item is to consider acceptance of executive session 1 and 2 minutes of April 25th, 2013. I have a motion to that effect.
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Gagliardi and seconded by Mr. Camara. Any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Five in the affirmative, two abstentions, Mrs. Rothwell and Mr. Ghilarducci abstain. Next item, consider acceptance of executive session minutes 1 and 2 for May 9th, 2013. May I have a motion to that effect?
So moved. Second.
Motion made by Ms. White and seconded by Mrs. Gagliardi. Any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Five in the affirmative, two abstentions, Mrs. Rothwell and Mr. Ghilarducci. And finally, consider acceptance of executive session minutes 1 and 2 of June 13th, 2013. May I have a motion to that effect?
So moved.
Second.
Motion made by Ms. White and seconded by Mr. Camara. Any discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Five in the affirmative, two abstentions, Mrs. Rockwell and Mr. Ghilarducci abstain. All right, I'd like to skip the first two items under old business for the moment, if there's no objection, and move to finalize meeting schedule for 2013-14. I distributed a short time ago, suggested alternative dates for those meetings where we had issues at our last meeting. I discussed these with Superintendent Lynch, and we're proposing either for the first September meeting, either the 4th, which would be the Wednesday after Labor Day, or the 11th. In January, January 22nd, and in February, February 19th. Any discussion regarding those dates?
Could you say those dates again?
Sure. There was an issue with the proposed September 9th date, so we're suggesting either September 4th, which would be a Wednesday, or September 11th. In January, it's in the material that I passed out before the meeting, perhaps over here. Rather than the 21st, the 22nd, and in February, rather than the 18th, the 19th. Those dates would be Wednesdays. September 4th is a Wednesday, as is the 11th.
So we're saying it's the 4th or the 11th?
Yes.
The
4th
is good.
Good looking.
The
4th
is good.
All right, then the 4th, the 23rd of January and the 19th of February, so I would entertain a motion to finalize our meeting schedule for 2013 by scheduling meetings on September 4th, January 22nd, and February 19th.
So moved. Second.
Motion made by Mrs. Gagliardi and seconded by Mrs. Rothwell. Any discussion?
Yes. Mr. Chairman, sir, the only thing I would like to do, I would like to include some Berkeley dates in the calendar, if we could work that out, please, because we don't have any, we have all these meetings scheduled, but I would like to inform Berkeley people we will be holding some meetings in Berkeley, so if we can come up with some dates we can hold meetings in Berkeley, I would appreciate it. Not at this time, but I would
appreciate it. Right. Thank you, that is an oversight, so. If we accept these dates, then I'll ask the superintendent to propose some dates for us to meet in Berkeley. Okay, so If there is no further discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. All right, next item, personnel issues. With respect to the business manager position, I've spoken to legal counsel. The matter, there is an item on the executive session agenda with respect to the business manager. Legal counsel has informed me that the item that is listed on the executive session agenda is not in compliance with the open meeting law, and that therefore we shouldn't take up this matter in executive session. Legal counsel has also indicated to me that our focus on this issue should be to request that the Somerset School Committee schedule an executive session with our committee to discuss process, which would fall under exception 2 to the open meeting law, which is to discuss a strategy with respect to not only negotiations for, but also with respect to the administration of contracts. And so that is the avenue that our legal counsel has recommended. We should sit down with the Somerset Committee in executive session and discuss the issues with respect to process. That is, as we've mentioned in the past, business manager is a joint employee of both committees. The contract provides that the committees, with respect to his position, the committees work jointly, and so I think that I'd be looking for the consensus of the committee that once we enter into our joint meeting, that we propose that we should attempt to schedule a meeting in executive session to discuss that process. And if anyone have any question, concern, further discussion?
Do I have a motion for that, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, let's see what Mrs. Rothwell, did you have something
just
to add?
Just for clarification, is that a meeting with the chairs only or for both committees as a whole?
No, that would be a meeting with
both
committees.
Thank you.
Is that so happen this evening?
No, it's not on the agenda.
My only concern is obviously that the Somerset K-3 has already undergone an investigation, already taking action against a joint employee. And so how is that going to work when you say process? It seems the process has already been undertaken by one of the joint parties without consultation or without any consideration of the other joint parties. So,
just to clarify, George, we haven't taken action.
Okay.
We did not take action as superintendent.
Okay. So does that mean we're going to have another joint session within the next days or weeks, or how is that going to unfold?
I think we should meet as soon as we can.
And which is an oversight that wasn't on the agenda for our joint meeting tonight with the Somerset K-3. We're meeting with them at 7:15.
I realize that.
But we can't discuss the process of, we can't discuss it openly in a joint open meeting.
Discuss what openly?
The business manager.
The process of how this is going to unfold. I mean, you have a joint employee, and it seems to me that the K-3 is doing an investigation of that joint employee without any input from the region. We should have a discussion about how that process unfolds.
I agree. And our legal counsel is advising us that should be done in this executive session.
Okay. Well, the question we have on the executive session.
that's our executive session agenda, and legal counsel has advised me that the wording of that item is not, does not satisfy the open meeting law.
I guess my only concern was I don't know what the Somerset K-3 meeting is tonight, but if it involves sort of picking an investigator or picking a forensic scientist, it seems to me that both parties would want to be involved in that process. You have one person, so if it's going to be an investigation, it should be done at a joint investigation under the contract. But I just don't want the Somerset K-3 to go ahead and make all these decisions without the region being involved.
And I think that's the point of meeting with them as quickly as possible, an executive session to discuss exactly what the process would be.
Kind of included in the spot on the agenda on our joint meeting, there's a business management position, we can certainly, since it's a joint meeting, we can discuss that scheduling and that process at that point. Outside of the executive session responsibility to apply.
So you're saying we can't discuss it, right? No, we said what we advise not to.
Right.
We were advised not to discuss it in open session, yet the wording for executive session does not comply with the open meeting. So there's two things that are. Am I understanding that correctly?
Our legal counsel is recommending that we discuss the strategy with respect to addressing the business manager situation in executive session. That is separate and apart from any discussion with respect to performance. And the legal counsel advises that a discussion of performance in executive session is not appropriate. The next item is athletic director, and Mrs. Lynch has scheduled a meeting with the Somerset Teachers Association to discuss the athletic director position. That's an item that is on our executive session agenda, and we can discuss that in more detail at that time.
I'll be meeting with Mrs. Dakota at the end in the Somerset Teachers Association later this week.
The next item is the special needs director position. And once again, that position is also on our executive session agenda. I don't know if there's anything to report with respect to that position in open session, but I believe.
I'll be meeting with the Teachers Association regarding that position as well.
The next item is technology staffing, and once again, that item is on our executive session agenda. I believe we are at the point where we need to pursue, at least on a preliminary basis, a hiring of a network manager, and we have a description for that job position. I would suggest that our position in meeting with the Somerset Committee jointly is that while we continue to be willing to discuss this technology staffing, that it is necessary for us to move forward with that position. We need to be prepared for the new building, and it's been clear from our consultant that we need someone in that role. And so I would suggest or propose that we authorize the superintendent to post that position. The fact that we post it does not necessarily mean that we have to hire someone for that position. but we would be, we would find out what response we're receiving, who the applicants are, what the salary requirements are to fill that position, and we could ultimately make a decision down the road, depending on the response we get to the posting, as to whether we actually fill the position. Is there any discussion?
What, I mean, there must be some salary range that we're looking at. The budget would only allow us to do so much.
Well, we would, once we saw the responses and what the range of salary is, and we would propose a salary in the posting of, as recommended by the our technology consultants, in the range of $60,000 to $70,000. Once again, we wouldn't fill the position unless we were satisfied that the funds were available in the budget.
But we don't know that until after we post?
We, I think it's fair to say that we feel that we can make adjustments in the budget so that we can fill that position, whether depending on. We know that we have some savings already in terms of the teaching positions that we've filled so far, which are at a significant savings to the salaries of the individuals who are being replaced. But we would certainly come to the committee with the information as to exactly where the money is coming from before we fill the position.
And is the $60,000 to $70,000, has that been discussed with the vendor, as that's the market rate for the skill set that we're looking for?
Yes.
And we're using that job description developed by the consultants. Is that,
yes.
That's the same job description. Okay.
And we'd also be looking for someone that can also assist teachers with technology integration as well.
Okay.
Because we can have all the equipment in the world, but if the teachers aren't trained adequately on how to implement it, how to use it in the classroom in a daily lesson, you might as well not even have it.
And again, we don't have to commit to anything. It's just putting it out there, given the time frame that we're at right now.
Yes.
To see what type of interest we get.
Yes.
It's a posting based on budgetary approval or something.
Yes, exactly.
But you mentioned tech integration. This is for that yet. This is strictly for the network.
Well, I do.
It would be a combination.
Combination.
Right. Okay.
Having sat on the technology task force and even on the building committee technology discussions, that skill set that was written up in that job description, I think it's very that it makes sense to try to see if we can get somebody with those qualifications to help us prepare for that transition. Even in planning for the new building, there have been some questions that have come up as far as how to plan for it, what technology will fit in the bigger square. Again, it's just to put it out there. I agree that we need to see how it matches our budget and how that goes out, but I think the skill set is certainly needed.
Will we receive an updated copy of the posting?
Sure.
Okay.
Sure.
And is there a projected start date, or is this just a preliminary, throw it out there to see what type of candidates come forward? It sounds like we want to have it in, have a person in place before the school. So is that a January start, or is that still?
I think as soon as possible.
As soon as possible.
This was actually proposed to the school committee some time ago, and the assessment was completed, and that those needs are identified. So
once again, the budget will determine when, what this, to some degree, what the start date would be. If we feel we can implement it quickly, fine. If we have to wait until January 1st, based on the budget, then that's a possibility as well.
Well, this, because of the tech integration specialist, and on the K-8 side, we talked about those positions that in our own technology task force, would it make sense for us to put that on the agenda as well with the K-8 discussion?
Is this a high school position?
I think it was just
a
high school. Well, when we proposed it, I don't know if it's changed, but when we proposed
well,
it,
well, if it's melding and morphing into something a little bit different, then it might be worth discussing a lot.
The only thing I would worry about is that it would slow the process. This is trying to put it out there to see what the feelers are, and then to kind of hold that back again.
With the size of the new high school and the scope of the technology plan for the high school and the integration, I think it would just be for the high school.
So the primary responsibilities would be building a network for the anticipated opening in September 2014 for the high school. Is that so we're creating a position to help put the networking up for the high school? Or is it a broader job description or scope than that?
Sounds like it's an addition of professional development for the teachers as well.
Exactly. We also train the teachers on the new equipment that's coming into their classroom.
Right, but it's all geared towards integrating from to the new high school.
Yes.
Is that why the K-8 wouldn't sort of, it's just all geared towards the teacher development and developing network of high school?
Yes, because of the scope and the technology plans going into that new high school, the teachers have to be ready to use it.
But we have ongoing discussions with the Somerset Committee regarding technology staffing, and we'll be happy to entertain any discussion that the Somerset Committee wants to bring to the table as we continue to discuss the technology positions, because this doesn't resolve some of the other issues that we've been talking about, which really haven't been able to come, we haven't been able to come to a consensus on as yet.
Yeah, I think it's important to include them, so thank you.
All right. So.
Do you need a motion?
Yes.
I'll make a motion to instruct the superintendent to post for the network manager position for the high school using the job description as created by our consultants, Tech Edge, for the inclusion of some technology integration duties as well.
To be filled as the budget permits?
To be filled as the budget permits.
Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
All right, motion made by Mrs. Gagliardi and seconded by Ms. White. Is there any further discussion? In the absence of discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? I'm unanimous. Okay, next position, Director of Music and Fine Arts, and possible change of current structure. I believe Mr. Lynch, you have a recommendation with respect to that position as a result of discussion with Mr. Medeiros?
I did meet with Mr. Medeiros earlier in the week, and we came up with, again, there are several scenarios here. One of them is to appoint an interim director of music and fine arts for K-12. Another option, again, is to separate the positions into a director of music and a director of art. However, if people want a continuation of the programs for music, for art and for music all the way through, Mr. Medeiros has indicated that K-8 really doesn't want to have the two positions, so he would be in favor of the interim director of music and fine arts and keeping that as is one position. However, if we were to break it out to two separate positions, the music being one and the art being the other, he doesn't favor that option. So the again, the option that we both came up with was the interim. However, the option of separating them out is still a possibility, understanding that it would not have the support of the superintendent in K-8.
That's even when you talk about separating art and separating music, that's remaining the K-12. So we'd have an art director K-12, we'd have the music director K-12.
Right, that's what I had mentioned, and he believes that there wouldn't be an appetite to separate them out into two positions for the K-8. They'd just be there would be an appetite to keep the an interim director for music and fine arts as one person, as one position, but not in breaking them up. And I believe the reason for that is for the limited number of teachers at the elementary K-8 level.
To me, it doesn't make sense to do anything but separate the art and the music. Remain K-12. The appetite's there now. I don't see that changing. And financially, it makes sense. So on an instructional level, I think that's the best option for us. And on a financial level, if we're appointing a teacher from the art K-12 and we're appointing a teacher from the music K-12 and we're giving them stipends and we're splitting that, I don't know if it's 60-40 right now, and that remains the same, that's not going to come out to the same salary as we're paying right now. So this just, it doesn't make sense to do anything but consider positions separately, art and music, remain the K-12, because there's obviously a concern from parents in the community. I think, especially the music folks, are kind of edgy about getting that program up and going. And I think it's important that we acknowledge those two separate content areas, because they are very separate. Simply proven by the fact that you're not gonna find someone who's certified in both. And I'm sorry, but that's just unacceptable. Put someone in that kind of a position who doesn't hold a certification in those areas.
Anyone else?
I would agree that it holds a lot of merit to look at separating that out. But what I'm hearing from Superintendent Lynch is that at this point, within the K-8 committee or from that superintendent, there isn't the willingness to do a separate director of art K-12. And a separate director of music K-12.
Well, we don't know what they can do.
Well, this is
what superintendent.
Right. But I think that there is some value, and I think that we should definitely look at that long term. But I think there is some value, if we can't work that out at this point, to do just a 1 year interim of what we currently have, just to spend the time to really look at it. That's in our budget. That's in their budget.
This also, I'm sorry, Mr. Lynch, correct me if I'm wrong, but I have a really hard time believing that we can't appoint two teachers that we have on staff currently, give them a stipend, and not be under what we're paying the position that Laurie Anderson held. It didn't work for me. On the paper, we came under. Doesn't matter how you want to label it, we would come under. We'd be acknowledging people in those two fields. We'd still have that consistency with the K-12. And if you wanted to try that for a year to see if it held water and it was as valid as I feel it is, then great. But if this committee is pushing for the content coordinator to stay the same and to spend $90,000 on a position that we obviously is not in the best interest of the kids instructionally, it's just not. It doesn't make sense. Then I will implore everyone here to please go with the art for the certification, because if it doesn't matter, and you're just putting someone in there just to get things going, then I think we should be posting that position for an art certification. If they have the music, great.
But I think we have a vacant, we don't have strings classes at the high school that yet need to be covered.
Which I think can be covered this stuff. It's two classes, and I'm coming up with every day of the week.
My perspective on it is that I think we should seriously look at separating the art and music directors with perhaps two content coordinators. However, it's critically important that we fill this position as soon as possible. As a matter of fact, we're really behind schedule in terms of filling this position. In terms of budgeting, the K-8 school district is budgeted for the single position and their share of the salary. I think we should put them on notice that as we look at the budget for fiscal 15, that we'll be looking seriously at changing this position, and we can work with them to do it. But I think if we try to change the positions now, it could have collective bargaining implications. Mr. Lynch is, it's not all, let me take a step back. It's not always easy to schedule collective bargaining sessions promptly. We had some delay in scheduling the one that's now on the agenda for the 9th.
I don't, could you just explain to me how that would be a collective bargaining, that position is eliminated, we've had a retirement, we're not filling that position?
Because the administrator's collective bargaining agreement, well, I hesitate to argue the union's case, but the fact is that the position of Director of Music and Fine Art is specifically set forth in the collective bargaining agreement. If we don't fill that position, then the issue becomes whether there is an obligation on our part, if the union requested, to sit down and negotiate what the new positions will be and what the salary level will be for those positions. So it's just going to take a significant amount of additional time, I think, to try to deal with this situation now. I think we're much better to move forward, fill the position on an interim basis for 1 year. We can post the position as certification in either art or music, or preferably both, and see if we have qualified candidates who apply for an interim position.
I'm headed into my 12th year on the committee. So we're looking at 3-4 contract negotiation episodes, situations, whatever you want. It's been brought up every time. And yet, here we are. And for the folks in music that are here tonight, the impact has hit music as well as it has art. I mean, take a look at when this was a separate, they were two separate departments, and where we are after they combined those two departments. Music has taken a hit. The band used to be busloads of kids. It's not. Strings, I mean, they were on the stage, up the aisles. There wasn't enough room. There weren't enough instructors. There were so many kids. That's dwindled. So it's impacted music as well. I don't know, for the life of me, I have trouble understanding if the dollars are there in the budget on both sides, and I believe that they are, and we're looking at teachers in staff that we're going to be giving stipends to take over K-12 to oversee their department, which is their specialty that they have certification in and obviously a passion for, why would we turn this down or not? I just have a difficult time with that.
Well, I would say, just in response to that specifically, we realize that there are issues in the music area with respect to participation, etc. I don't think we can address those. Those are significant policy issues that we need to come to grips with. I think we can do that the next year.
My example is not just impacting the art. At one point, the art department was so well known that kids who put portfolios together to get into art schools were not turned down if they came from Somerset High. You don't see that. I'm sorry, you're just not seeing that anymore. is not happening. How can it be? It's unrealistic for asking one person to do that.
Well, we hear, from my perspective, I hear what you're saying, Liz. I think it has merit, and I think we can take the time over the next year to address it. This matter may have been discussed in the past, but this is a new committee, and we're making a commitment to look very seriously at both positions and to address it over the course of the next year. But at the same time, we need to have a person in place as quickly as possible. We have a tremendous amount of activity going on over the course of the summer, and we need someone to be in charge. So I realize it may not be the ideal solution, but I think it's the best for the present.
From a KDA perspective, and I can't speak for a lawyer or anybody else on our committee, I don't think that we're totally against discussions on separating out art versus music. I know we've had those discussions internally in some of our other meetings. I don't think the committee is against that. I think it's the structure of it and how it's going to be laid out that we need to work together on. So that's why, I totally get you.
And I understand, and not to insult, but just not reassuring. That comment of we're not against discussing, that's not reassuring.
I can't speak for anybody else. I just know that, obviously the community has been committed to music, and, we've certainly seen, like you said, the numbers dwindle and on both ends. I'm not saying that, we're against that as a committee. I can't speak for anybody else, but I think it, at least from this perspective, doing the interim, posting it as Mr. Peirce suggested, I think is good for this year. This gives us the opportunity to look at it, and really, if we need to seriously look at the budget numbers in the following budget cycle, then I think we need to do that. I would go with the concept of an interim. I think it's the best way. It might not be the perfect way to resolve it at this point, but I think it's the best way at this point, and give us the opportunity to come up with a good plan to separate them.
Is there a motion?
Well, isn't this on the agenda with the Somerset City Authority and the joint meeting? So why don't we just ask the Somerset City Authority and the joint meeting what their thoughts are, and then they vote. If they agree with separating it out, it seems like a pretty good idea. If they don't, then it's on the agenda with the Somerset City Authority. We keep wondering what they're going to do, so why don't we just ask them to join that?
I think we should go to that meeting with at least a position with respect to how we address the director of music and fine art, because we need to resolve it as quickly as possible. I think it should have been addressed sooner. Now is the time to get it resolved tonight. So we go with direction. Obviously, we're open to discussion, but I think the motion could be worded that it is our preference that we proceed in this way.
Can I make a motion then that we post the interim position for Director of Music and Fine Arts with the certification recommendations that you made, either or preferably both?
No, I'd like to amend that to.
Well, let me see if there's a second to the motion. All right, so we have a motion to indicate at the joint meeting that the committee's preference is to fill the director of music and fine art position on an interim basis for 1 year, including a certification in either music or art, preferably both. All right, is there a discussion?
Yeah, I was going to say that. As George said, if there is readiness on the part of the K-12 to go the K-12 art director and the K-12 music director, and we can do it in a timely fashion, that would be something. But I'm just concerned that we cannot do that in the time frame that's needed. So that's why I would say that this is a better plan for the interim.
Ms. White.
Can I say something before? It seems to me our superintendent indicates splitting off the best thing to do. You indicate it's the best thing to do. Liz indicates the best thing to do. But we're saying the union might hold us up. Well, since when is that competitive? If it's the best thing for the kids, it seems like everybody should be involved. It should be done quickly, split, get the union involved, and get it done. I don't understand. We delay things so many times. And it gets frustrating to me. I'm sure it's frustrating to everyone in this room. If it's the best thing for the kids, everyone should be involved. The union should be involved. The quick strategy session is done, and you get it over. I don't understand why everything needs to take years to develop. Everyone here seems to think it's the best idea for the kids, so let's just get it done. And if the K-8 is agreeing with that, then we set up a quick union session next week, next Monday, next Tuesday, get everyone involved and get it done. It doesn't seem like it has to take so long, years of consultation to get something done that seems to make sense to me. So, I mean, if we just meet with the K-8 says no, it seems we're happy the way it is, we don't want to do it, then we go with the interim position. If they're on board with it, then we just get it done. Doesn't seem complicated.
Alright, so.
This motion is just for preference.
Yes. Okay, so, Liz, do you have an amendment?
I do.
Okay.
I'd like the certification in both art and music.
Alright, so Ms. White is proposing that the person who fills the position on an interim basis has to be certified in both music and art. Is there a second? Okay, if there is no second, then we'll move on to the motion. Any further discussion? All right, all those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All right, Mr. Camara, how do you vote?
Aye.
Mrs. Rothwell?
I had a question. We can jump ahead. Can I ask a question before I vote, or?
We'll
then I would have to say nay, then.
We'll allow you to ask a question. Go ahead.
Okay. Otherwise, I'd have to say nay. Liz, in your opinion, is it realistic to find someone on this short-term basis that has a certification of both, with your experience?
I don't think it's realistic. However, I feel that it's in the best interest of the kids. I'm not looking for the quick fix or the easy way out or the least friction. I'm looking for what's right for the kids in our district. So I don't mind taking a week to figure it out, like George said. To me, rushing this along just sends a message that the people that want to push this through don't really have an interest in where the certification lies. Because I can't see them saying we don't care about art. So they must not care about the certification. Therefore, I'll support art, certification in art, because I think that the art department over the years has taken a tremendous hit. I'm watching it happen to the music department. I am nervous, it scares me that these two departments are falling apart because they're usually the first two to go. It's phys ed, it's health, it's art, it's music. And it's happening before our eyes, and it's slowly happening, and I don't think that people are realizing that somebody's pulling the plug and it's draining. So,
I've heard everything you say, and I don't want to keep belaboring, but my fear is that if we vote on this and it's unrealistic, then we are not going to be able to move forward. That would be my fear.
I believe that Mr. Lynch probably, I believe he shared with me previously in a meeting his perspective on how likely it is to find a person who's certified in both art and music, particularly on an interim basis.
It's very unlikely to find a person that's certified in both, especially at the high school level.
So, okay, so having responded to your question, Mrs. Roth, how do you vote?
Nay.
You vote no?
No.
Okay. All right. Ms. White?
No.
Okay. Mr. Gagliardi?
Aye.
All right. Mr. Kelly?
No.
Mr. Ghilarducci?
Nay.
All right. And the chair votes aye, so that's four in the negative, and three in the affirmative.
Can we offer another suggestion?
Sure.
So that we go prepared. How about if we go in there recommending to the K-8 that we have a K-12 art director and a K-12 music director? And if it is amenable, then try to work with Mr. Kelly in the next short term to get that.
my motion.
That's my motion.
I'll second it.
Is there any further discussion?
Yes. Superintendent Lynch, in your opinion, going the suggested route now with the stipend, because I'm assuming that's what you mean.
I said investigating a K through 8 music director and a K through 12 art director. And what I understand is that committee of chairs and vice chairs has looked at that, and budget-wise, it's comparable. So I don't know the specifics about that, because I wasn't privy to those conversations,
well,
but that there is...
If we don't hire a new person, if we hire two brand new people, it's going to be twice as costly. However, if you promote two people that are currently on staff, you take two people on staff, you promote them to director, you use the salary of the former music and fine arts director, you divide that between those two positions, you'd be at a savings. And you may, with the understanding, is you may have to hire, depending on who the person is, and depending on the workload, maybe Dr. Mosley knows, but as far as I know, Mrs. Anderson's taught two string classes. So if we brought in someone, whether it be a retired person or a part-time person to teach two classes, obviously that would cost a little bit more. But I think if we promoted two people from within Somerset and Somerset Berkley K-12, anywhere along that line, if you promoted a person from the art department to be the director, a person from the music department to be director, and hired somebody part-time to teach those couple of classes that Mrs. Anderson taught, so those rooms are covered, and those instructional practices are covered, I believe it'd be a savings in K through 12.
I'll make that motion, but it's also for interim. I don't know if you want to back out your second, but that motion would be for an interim, but it would be along those two lines, K through 12 art, K through 12 music. And I'm offering that because the other motion didn't pass. Again, I think that...
And we'd also have to look, Mr. Furtado brought to my attention, at the structure of the contract, because if somebody is promoted to a director, they may have a reduced teaching level. So we'd also have to look at that, at the structure.
And my concern about this is that we haven't studied it carefully. Right now, we're paying about 80% of the salary of the director of music and fine art. I don't know whether that's a fair distribution, if we're going to have a director of art. I don't know how many art teachers there are at the middle school and the elementary school versus the number of art teachers at the high school. So I don't know whether us paying 80% of that salary is a fair distribution of salary. And the same is true in the music program. We're paying 80% of the salary. I don't believe so. What is the percentage?
60-40 for fine arts and music and
60-40. So I stand corrected then, 60-40. But nonetheless, I would be looking at this more carefully before we make a decision. But nonetheless, the motion on the floor is to recommend the hiring of a director of art and the collective bargaining agreement provides for a content coordinator for those positions on an interim basis for 1 year. That motion?
Yes.
Do we need to present K-8 with a person? I mean, we're gonna have a joint meeting anyways.
Well, we were.
I mean, it seemed as if it was.
I don't mean to cut you off, but at our last meeting, we danced around this, and it was left to return the matter to the superintendents for them to bring a recommendation. We have the superintendent's recommendation. Decided not to follow it. I think we need to go to this meeting with a definite position so we can get this resolved. As I said, it's from at least from my personal perspective, it's absolutely crucial that we act on this and get it done. We've known for months that Lori Anderson was retiring from this position, and there's been too much delay for whatever reason, and we need to get it done. So if there's no further discussion, all those in favor of the motion?
Aye.
Aye.
Mr. Camara?
Aye.
All right, six in favor, I'm opposed, I vote no. All right, on the item of moderate special needs teacher, I think Mr. Lynch has something to report on that issue.
Yes, we have hired a moderate special needs teacher. So that position has been filled. And it's Ms. Erin Ross.
And that will
allow us to develop a program that will allow us to keep students in the district that would normally be placed in an outside placement. Those students are right now in a from K through grade 8. Those students have been in the regular school, and this will allow us to develop a program and keep those kids in Somerset Berkley Regional High School.
Is this the same program we discussed when we were doing the budget process?
Yes.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is June 21 correspondence and corrective action report from DESE. Mr. Lynch, do you have anything to report? One of the concerns that I had was in this corrective action report, there's certain information or filings that the report indicates weren't filed in a timely manner. We know.
Regarding the cafeteria?
Yes.
Yes, I spoke to Mr. Furtado on that today, and the Department of Education people came in 2006, then they came in 2012 and found that the changes that they suggested were not made. However, when they came in earlier this spring, they were satisfied that the changes were being made. Anything to add on that?
Sure. Mr. Chairman, what you have is the outcome of all the changes we made from the 2012 corrective action plan. I did not have copies of those in my office. I don't know where they went. I do know that the 12 and 6 action plans are identical. They were probably about 12 pages. What you have in front of you is what is left to accomplish after all of the work done to clean up the 2006 and 2012 corrective action plans. That was that memo that you have was answered with DESE in July to their satisfaction. And we should expect, again, a follow-up visit from DESE sometime in the spring to see how operations are going in regard to these last few items.
All right, so when it says in this report, for example, supplemental financial report, repeat violation, fiscal year 12, that means that the violation was a result of their inspection in 12 and it's been addressed since then?
No, that item was part of the 2012 corrective action report, was part of the 2006 corrective action report, and has carried through on their follow-up visit in the spring of 2013. The items on that list are the carried through, but it has not been addressed yet.
So
we have submitted corrective action plans for those items to DESE and to their satisfaction.
All right, so can we obtain copies of what's been submitted?
Yes.
In response to this corrective action? Any other questions from the committee?
So we'll get a copy of what the plan was that the DESE found to be satisfactory.
Yes.
Okay.
All right, under budget and financial matters, are there any budget transfer requests?
None at this time, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Next item is final FinStat report, which I distributed to the committee. on everything, all the information I've been provided with, we ended the year with a surplus, and I would also mention that we did have a negative or a cost in the food service line item, but that loss was anticipated. I've been aware of it for several months. It's based upon various factors, which we can discuss in executive session, because they involve personnel issues. But our budget is balanced for fiscal 2013, and we have a lot of surplus.
And this surplus takes into consideration that loss?
Yes. And the documents that I circulated provide all of that information. All right, next item is NASBO certification for the regional treasurer. You also have in the information that I circulated to you today, an email from the regional treasurer, Lindsay Albanaz. I actually have encouraged her to obtain this information. It's obviously subject to approval of the committee, but I think that it would be beneficial to the regional school district to have our treasurer certified as a business manager. The business manager is required to be certified. See that outlined in the email are the elements of the program that begins in September and ends in June. It requires the treasurer to spend some evenings and Saturdays in this program. There are a few Fridays in the schedule, but mostly evenings and Saturdays. The cost of the program is $4,750. And I personally would urge the committee to approve this expenditure. It gives us versatility in the position. I think it's something that we should support.
I make the motion to enroll her in the program at the cost of $4,750.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Ghilarducci and seconded by Mrs. Gagliotti. Is there a discussion?
Is this in a budget or in a contract, or do we have a contract for the treasurer to pay for extra teaching, or?
We have a professional development line in the budget in which this would come. There is also a provision in the treasurer's contract that says that if for any reason he's no longer employed by us by her choice, then she's responsible for reimbursing us for the cost on a proportional basis depending on the number of years.
To drill down on Mr. Kelly's point, obviously we budgeted for next year for professional development for the teachers. This is something that's in addition to that. So is it a possibility or is it plausible that professional development for the teachers could be handled by us?
I would say no. That would be my view. Mr. Lynch?
No, I don't believe it would be.
That would be my only concern. I mean, I'm all for professional development with all of our employees.
I just don't want to set a precedent where we pay someone else needs to, you know what I mean? Have we done this in the past where we pay for, if it's in a contract, I have no problem. And if it's funded, I have no problem. I just don't want to set precedents where we start paying for people's professional development outside of their contracts or outside of our obligations. That's all.
All right, so I will refresh you historically, we paid for Mrs. Antonellis to take this course. And once she completed it and was certified, she went to work for Old Rochester as their business manager. We had no recourse. In Mrs. Albanass's contract, we covered that issue by saying that so long as she's employed by us for 3 years, we cover this expense. If she leaves any time before that, she's obligated to reimburse us either the full amount, two-thirds, or one-third, depending on how long she's employed.
Well, again, Mr. Kelly, can we make the motion that it's a non-precedent setting vote, you know, to try to satisfy the point that in the future we're not obligated or that there's no discussion that we've done in the past for others? And
well, it was negotiated to an individual contract. Not a precedent necessarily. It just we seemed like we closed a loophole that was sitting open previously that we didn't benefit from. So I think it makes sense. It's obviously been negotiated under this contract. That's fine. I think it's
it's a negotiation tool for someone coming into the position. That's all. Right.
Well, I think it's. Let me also mention. Mrs. Albanass is a certified public accountant. She's required to take a certain number of credits every year, which we would pay for, while the credits that she's taking wouldn't amount to the amount of this program. They would represent some part of it. So she would also obtain those credits that she requires to maintain her CPA certification, which is a benefit to us. To have our regional treasurer as a certified public accountant. She brings a very special skill set to the job, so I think all in all, it's a clear benefit for the region.
Just to clarify, I'm not saying that Lindsay is not qualified to do this position. I'm just concerned with position benefit. So, to Mr. Kelly's point,
well, I don't see any reason why there'd be a problem including in the motion that it's without precedent in the future. Can I have an amendment to that effect?
Can you help me? I'd like to make a motion that we approve professional development for Lindsay Alvarez to become certified in, is it MASPO? Am I correct?
Business manager. MASPO certification as a business manager.
To approve the cost of the expense of the course for the certification, non-precedent setting.
All right, is there a second on that
second.
Amendment? Okay. Motion, an amendment proposed by Mrs. Rothwell and seconded by Ms. White. All is in favor of the amendment?
Aye.
All right, all is in favor of the motion as amended?
Aye.
Okay. Unanimous and both counts. If they satisfy the reasons set forth in the open meeting law, one would be illness, one would be distance away from the location of the meeting, for example, in case of a business trip or a vacation. There are certain limitations that require the chair to approve remote participation on a case-by-case basis. The purpose of putting this on the agenda is just to explore whether the committee is open to that process so that we can prepare a written policy which would be presented by the committee and adopted at a future meeting. Any discussion on that thing?
Nothing to do
with it. All right, so a motion to move forward with drafting a formal policy with respect to remote participation at regional school committee meetings.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, motion made by Mrs. Rothwell and seconded by Mrs. Gagliardi. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. We had several items scheduled for executive session. It would appear, since it's after 7:10, that it's unlikely we even have time to enter executive session. So, let's see how we can cover those items at this time. There are, we can turn to there are three items that were included on the agenda, Mr. Kelly, because you have suggested them. One is relates to a policy with respect to discipline of joint employees, a three-district subcommittee to explore greater collaboration, and four contracts and compensation for administrative personnel. Do you have a preference as to which one of those you take up?
All three, but just the discipline of joint employees, obviously what's happened recently, there's no procedures in place in how we go about disciplining and or investigating joint employees. My understanding of the contracts would be, would have to be a joint investigation or a joint discipline involved. So I think we need as a committee to come up with a policy as to how we're going to go about disciplining, if we need to discipline joint employees. And my sense would be, need to be a joint discipline and a joint investigation. Everything has to be collaboratively together. For instance, if we have a problem with one of the joint employees, we should not go off on our own and hire investigators or subcommittees or discipline the person, because I think it would be invalid. If the other party wasn't involved, if you have two people, they both parties need to be involved. So we have no policy right now of how we discipline or investigate joint employees, but I think it's something that we need to come up with.
So I will speak with the chair of the Somerset School Committee and try to develop a subcommittee to work on that issue. I think it's 7:15. We need to recess our meeting and so that we can reconvene in joint session with the Somerset School Committee. Have a motion to that effect.
Second.
Motion made by Mr. Ghilarducci and seconded by Mr. Camara. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?